With Smuggler's Blues, director Paul Michael Glaser opens with the man pleading to save the lives of his family. Through subtitles, we see him state the following: "I got to think of my family, my sons, and because that's my family, and my family's more important than anything." This is notable, as throughout virtually all of executive producer Michael Mann's work, one consistent image is that of men protecting women and children, families. Whether it be something as small as Sonny buckling Isabella's seatbelt on their way to Cuba in Miami Vice, or something as dramatic as Vincent Hanna struggling to save the life of his stepdaughter after she's attempted suicide in Heat.
It's okay, baby. All right, let's get a doctor. Let's go, a doctor here. Here's your mom. Okay, your mom is here.
Or this scene in Manhunter, where we get a clear understanding of Will Graham's motivation.
Give it up. Forget this, Smuck. It's too damn late.
I gave it up. Till you showed up with pictures of two dead families, knowing goddamn well that I'd imagine families 3, 4, 5, and 6, right?
Glaser's direction in Smuggler's Blues keeps this idea of man as protector front and center. His use of character placement within the frame, also known as blocking or staging, silently reinforces this idea whenever the female vice detectives, Trudy and Gina, are on screen. Early in the episode, Glaser gives us this shot, which is actually foreshadowing what is to come. Surrounded by Crockett, Tubbs, and Switek, Gina is completely shielded and is in no imminent danger. Trudy, on the other hand, is outside their protection and vulnerable. In the subsequent scene, a clear progression can be seen in the male character's positioning in relation to Trudy. Here, Trudy is surrounded by Castillo and Waters and is in a safe and protected position. As the scene continues, Castillo is the overbearing presence that is protecting her when Trudy is on screen. In this shot, as Castillo turns around, Trudy is literally in his shadow. He is shielding her, and she is still in a very safe and protected position. In another shot, this time it's Crockett doing his part to block or shield Trudy. It's not until Agent Waters makes his announcement regarding Trudy's role is she then shown completely isolated in the frame.
You're staying here. You're the family bait.
For the first time in the episode, she is shown alone in the frame, and she is now vulnerable. As the scene ends, Crockett and Tubbs hand their badges over to Castillo and leave. Crockett, on the way out, looks first at Agent Waters, then glances back at Trudy as he clearly shows concern. Castillo shows the same concern as Trudy is no longer in his shadow. His shadow is now seen on the wall. Later, Tubbs drops off Trudy at the hotel, and once again, she is in the frame all alone, now completely isolated and unprotected. Now, just a quick note, Gina does not appear in Piñero's script after page 5. In the episode, of course, Gina does reappear, and once again, she is shown entirely shielded and surrounded by male officers, and as soon as possible, Crockett immediately steps in front of her, shielding her from potential danger. When Gina begs Castillo to let her help save her partner, Castillo completely ignores her.
Please, let me go in there.
Crockett, take him in.
Inside the trailer, once again, Trudy is seen alone in the frame, of course, and is it me or is she bound and in the kitchen? Gina is shown again, and once again, she is completely surrounded and protected by her male colleagues. Ultimately, after all is said and done, Trudy has been saved, and in the closing shot, she is now back surrounded and protected, not by her female partner, but by Crockett and Tubbs. Glaser's careful use of character placement is not only involving Gina and Trudy. There is a very interesting visual motif throughout the episode regarding Crockett and Tubbs.
Seems like a pretty big operation to be moving people to Cartagena.
Not people, just you two. You get in a jam, you're on your own.
The image of them displayed back to back reinforces the idea that Crockett and Tubbs have each other's back. They only have each other to depend on, and they are willing to fight for and defend their partner no matter the cost. Here are several examples of Crockett and Tubbs being displayed back to back. So what happens when Tubbs is arrested and Crockett is unable to be there for him? Tubbs is shown with a bare back. Without Crockett, he is completely exposed and vulnerable. Once they are reunited, they solidify their partnership again, as seen in this pull focus shot, which is the exact same shot as the one in the opening teaser, when Switek and Zeta were backing up Crockett and Tubbs.
Switek, how's it shaking?
The three acts of Smuggler's Blues can be categorized in this manner. Act 1 is film noir. It has great use of dark streets, run-down buildings, extremely shady characters, and a vivid use of shadows. One of the more striking shots in the entire series is in this episode. It's this one. This very noirish shot perfectly symbolizes exactly what Crockett and Tubbs do in their daily job. They hide their true selves and make their way through the dark and corrupt underworld. So if Act 1 is film noir, and Act 3 is basically a race against the clock thriller, Act 2 definitely references a western. One of the pivotal scenes in the episode is when Crockett and Jimmy are alone in the hotel. Crockett's great line immediately gives us the image of the Wild West.
This place is like Dodge City, 1985.
And after the deal with Grossero is done, Crockett rides out on a Mustang. Then they eventually make their escape in Jimmy's plane, and previously, Jimmy described it this way.
The guy who sold it to me said it was a lemon. I'm telling you, it may look like a cow, but she runs like a stallion.
The scene with Crockett and Jimmy is also important for the connection they make over their experiences in Vietnam. This bonding moment comes back to help them later when some not-so-hidden symbolism is used and Jimmy gets them out of a jam. Glaser also uses subtle touches of irony by giving the audience small details that refer to something that happened in a previous scene. For example, when Crockett and Tubbs realize they've seen this woman before. Also, that scene itself refers back to when Tubbs was spinning Tucker. This time it's Tubbs that is being spun. I wanted to talk a little about that poster that's plastered all over the streets of Cartagena. Here is the English version of that poster. Luis Colindres was a student at the University of San Carlos in Guatemala, and in 1982 he was killed by what were said to be repressive forces. Unfortunately, I was unable to find more information as to why this poster was so prominently displayed in the episode. So if anyone knows why, please give a helping hand and let me know. I wanted to give some attention to Miguel Piñero's screenplay by providing you just a handful of descriptions in his script that I thought were interesting. In one of the scenes that was eventually scrapped, the Vice team is watching the previous night's surveillance footage, and they bring in a lip reader to explain exactly what was being said. Her name was Esperanza, and she was described in this manner. The great character Grossero was described in the following way. My favorite description was for the nightclub where they go to meet Grossero for the second time. Piñero used one line to describe the nightclub. The drug deal in the cemetery was originally written to take place in a soccer field. And finally, I'll leave you with this. On the way back to Miami, they used Glenn Frey's title song, but Piñero actually put a specific song in the description here, so I thought I would recreate the scene with his choice of music.
What it is.
Hey, Nicholas. My ace. What's up?